Hey, it's time for Dub Talk, but first it's time to let you know that this podcast contains strong language and adult themes. Oh snap, uh-oh. This podcast also contains spoilers, so you better be prepared, because it's ladies' night on Dub Talk. Get out your box wine, don't be scared. 2, 4, 6, 8, who do we appreciate? Cheer boys on Dub Talk. Go Breakers!
Hello one and all, and welcome to Dub Talk, the podcast where a group of cheerleaders get together and discuss their thoughts on a recent English dub announcement, or review the dub of a series that was released on DVD and Blu-ray. I'm Stephanie, and tonight has been a long time coming, because tonight is Ladies' Night!
Woo-woo! All hail Ladies' Night. Ladies' Night 3, the cheering.
Oh, God. It's not Electric Bungalow right now.
No, that was Prince of Stride. That was Lady Knights 2, Electric Boogaloo, and that was preceded with Ladies' Night, We Need Jesus.
I don't need Jesus, I just need some wine.
Yes.
There's a difference? Right.
God damn it. Of course, joining me in tonight's Ladies' Night are Megan and Gigi.
Excuse me, I am not Megan. I am Space Woman Hardina.
What? You can call me...
What?
I am Space Woman Hardina.
Oh, I get it. Wow. Wow, I'm not even drunk.
Not yet, you're not.
Hardy's gonna punch you in, like,
that's if Hardy can find me.
I bet he would track you down somehow. Oh my god. Anyway, as for the series, we'll be fangirling
over tonight.
What
he doesn't know doesn't hurt him. It's not like this is going on the internet or something.
Oh no.
Never. Who would listen to this? Rattle.
It's not on Instagram.
Oh, God, there's other things you could do,
just
like
several hundred people.
Masturbate to cat boys.
Ladies' Night, of course, off to a great start anyway.
And it wasn't
Gigi
for once.
We're going to be fangirling over today. We're going to be donning our cheer skirts and grabbing the pom-poms, because we're going to be discussing the casting announcement for Cheer Boys.
Woo!
It's one of 13 broadcast dubs coming out this summer.
Wait. This isn't taboo. God damn it, I'm out.
Megan, we're not going over this again.
Girl, you can't do this to me. You have to stay. Like, oh my god.
Girl.
Bro.
Oh wait, this isn't Free Eternal Summer.
No, I was editing Danganronpa just before. Just before doing the recording, so bro. Anyway, if you're unfamiliar with Cheer Boys, here's a quick little summary. Haruki Bando was born into a family of judo martial artists and expect to continue the family legacy. But he's about to trade judo for cheerleading when his childhood friend Kazuma Hashimoto invites him to join the Breakers, a male cheerleading club. Haru finds himself amongst a quirky group of boys. Can this squad of slightly odd and cute members make a breakthrough in college athletics?
On the bright side, we finally get a sports anime where all of the characters are legally fuckable.
Oh,
yeah.
Thank God.
Thank you.
So
thank you, college.
I feel so dirty now.
Just gonna drink some wine and watch these guys cheer. It's gonna be great. Anyway, as always, we're going to be tackling the press release from Funimation's blog, as well as a little bit of additional casting, with our own predictions, the actual casting, and our thoughts on the first 3 episodes of the English dub. Are we ready to somersault our way through this series?
Go! Fight! Win!
I barely can get at... I'm too fat to somersault!
I can't do a backflip. I can do a round-off, can't do a backflip to save my life.
I can't do jack shit but lay here and talk to you guys and drink wine, so...
That's a good
talent.
Idea, I like that idea. I like this idea. Anyway, so why don't we start off with the ADR director? Because we don't have an announcement or any word of who's writing the script as of now. We just have an ADR director. So, Was there any predictions for the ADR director, or maybe, because I also had predicted an assistant as well as a scriptwriter possibly for this show, so any and all predictions for a director, scriptwriter, anything like
yes.
that?
Yes. Mm-hmm. I had three director picks and at least one writing team.
I had one director, and I was right, so y'all have at it.
I hate you.
I can't believe you got this right.
I can't believe I got this right either.
I can't believe it's not butter.
Butter.
I have two directors, one assistant, and then one scriptwriter.
You have less than me. You go first.
But I'll say, we have to save Gigi for last. So, my two picks for ADR director, one was Caitlin Glass.
God damn it.
she one of your picks?
Yes.
Okay.
Get it, girl.
I mean, because Princess Stride is a thing. So I figured she would probably, if she wanted to go with another sports series, here we go, have at it. But she's doing Show by Rock Shorts, and is she doing one other thing this season?
She's doing one other thing, and I don't care about spoiling it because water is wet, the sky is blue. We all know Caitlin was directing Love Live Sunshine.
Yeah.
literally, hell would have frozen over, pigs would have fly, Hardy would be in a skirt, I don't know.
This is a weird
bacon would taste bad, wine wouldn't be alcoholic, and I would actually not be a flaming Fujoshi.
Oh, Lord. And I did have an assistant director for Caitlin specifically. I figured if she was working on more than one project, she would need an assistant. So, of course, because she has been working with her quite a bit, Tia Ballard was my favorite
assistant.
I hate
you so much!
We are on the same
page. Stop reading my mind!
Ladies, don't catfight already.
Let me guess what your writing team was. Is it Team Really?
I did half of that.
Which half?
I had the Rial half. I had the Monica half. For my scriptwriter. I didn't do both her and Josh. I did Monica at the very least. And my other director pick, for someone more, at least still fairly new, I actually had Kyle Phillips as my other choice for director.
Oh, thank God you didn't take my other male choice for director.
Okay, so I got mine out of the way. What were your other choices here, Megan?
So my actual main choice was Tia Ballard with Caitlin backing her up. I had it reversed.
Okay.
Because I figured Caitlin's doing Show by Rock Shorts, which isn't going to take up as much time because those episodes are only 5 minutes long. But I knew, like, legitimately, water is wet, the sky is blue, Caitlin Glass will direct Love Live Sunshine. Like, anarchy in the streets would have happened. There would have been riots. Bodies would be falling. Like, mass panic and chaos would have happened if that did not happen. The stars were aligned once every 1,000 years. For Caitlin to direct that show. So it was like, okay, so maybe Tia can take this and Caitlin can be on the other end because Caitlin's the only person who's written a sports anime, who's directed a sports anime at Funimation that didn't totally F it up.
Yeah.
Jerry and Tatum. mostly you, Tatum. So my other choice actually was because I wanted to throw the dog a bone. Because God forbid this poor bastard is a great actor, but mother of God, does somebody hate him in the producing department?
Oh,
I
no.
I said, let's give Cliff Chapin.
Oh, goodness gracious.
A try at this. Just because I wanted to see Cliff direct a good anime. instead
yeah.
of Divine Gate.
Yeah.
And then obviously I had Team Really, Josh Greeley and Monica Rial as my writing team, but if I had to have a backup, honestly, I'm gonna throw this out because she's friends with the director. I'm gonna throw out Terry Doty.
Okay. That makes sense. In terms of Clifford being the director, one of these days he'll get a damn decent show. Well, here's the thing. We're not covering this one. Planetarian, he's the director for Planetarian. I don't know how well that show is, but
short though. And he hasn't gotten to direct a quote-unquote good full-term series. Other than when they were like, okay, Cliff, we're really busy. Direct yourself through Assassination Classroom. Go! Which was actually a thing that happened.
It was a thing that happened?
Multiple times, actually.
Oh, well then, there you go. At least he gets a little bit of practice there. Okay, so, again, we don't have any word of an assistant director. We don't have any word of a scriptwriter. Now, Gigi, I don't know how you got this right, but can you please tell us who the ADR director for Cheer Boys is?
I can tell you who the ADR director for Cheer Boys is, and I picked this person because, well, number one, he's in my voice actor reverse harem, and I had to throw him somewhere. I did throw him somewhere else, but I thought he's kind of like getting his feet wet into directing lately, and I was like, maybe he'll do at least one show this season. And I had to pick a show that was like not overly popular, but like one that at least some people would love, aka FUNimation, which I am queen of. So I had to pick my man Aaron Dismuke.
Who is the ADR director for Cheer Boys.
What?
So, Gigi got this right.
I never get this right.
Again, I don't know how.
Sacrifice did you make to what demon to get this right, Gigi?
I just, like, from editing all those, the Dub Talk episodes, I was like, damn, I didn't even know Aaron Dismuke was a director. And I was like, oh, yeah, well, maybe he should do this show. I was like, it's pretty non-threatening, and he could have all his little boyfriends come over, and...
Gigi!
Not boyfriends. Like, I call you my girlfriends. Like, not...
Okay, true.
Not one word
I do call Lilac my wife.
Yeah, Megan refers to me as her waifu. But anyway, speaking
to
of
be
Aaron
fair,
Dismuke
you are waifu material, Steph.
Yes. So speaking of Aaron Dismuke in terms of directing, he's still fairly new with directing. In terms of the directing credits he's had, he was the assistant ADR director for a couple of episodes of Enride. He was the assistant ADR director for Fairy Tail as well as Fairy Tail Zero. Fairy Tail being Fairy Tail 2, not the original, like, God knows how many. And he was also the ADR director for Show Me and Sample. So, he doesn't have a lot of directing credits right now. But he's slowly working his way in there. And
yay.
Honestly, after
he
Show Me...
He does a really fucking good job at this.
About to say, after Show Me and Sample... I applaud you. Thank you. Give, like, it's kind of the same situation with Clifford Chapin. It's like, can we give him at least a rather decent show to direct? And here's Cheer Boys.
Boys, like, thank God
I applaud
for Cheer
you.
Boys.
I know, right? It's like, not really Fujo bait. It's a legitimate show.
Yeah, it really
there
is.
There are legitimate shows that are also Fujo bait. Boonico Stray Dogs is a thing that exists.
I don't know what that is. But you're saying it's Fujo bait, so should
one
I
day.
Watch it?
Yes.
I still have to finish the first season before.
So do I. But my Japanese husband's in it.
Of course.
And he's the villain. It's kind of hot.
Jesus. Anyway, how do we feel about the directing for Aaron Dismuke for Cheer Boys?
He does a really freaking good job.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was surprised by how well this is sounding so far.
Like, I'm really excited because it's kind of like downplayed. You'd think in a show with themes such as Cheer Boys that it could get completely out of hand and over the top funny, but it's actually not.
Yeah.
Everyone kind of sounds normal. Like, it's not out of the ordinary at all. So props to you for not taking the Fujo bait, Aaron Dismuke, and for making
yeah.
it sound like a legitimate show.
Yeah, because a lot of times, like, especially in recent years, when you see a sports kind of anime, there's always that Fujo bait. There's tends to be that Fujo bait, like, all the time. So, yeah, I agree. Like, this being more played as a straight series and them not taking the bait on it, it's great. Is there a few moments where there's some broiness to it? A little bit.
Yeah, but there has
but
to
honestly,
be.
But honestly, it's so tasteful about it.
Yeah,
like,
it's laid out rather well compared to, like,
Free.
For example. Like,
I still say that Caitlin Glass and Monica really took the cake with Princess Stride.
Yeah.
Princess Stride was really well done.
Oh, Prince of Stride. Let's not talk about that before I get all hot and bothered.
Are you still salty about parts of Princess Stride's casting?
I'm still salty about it, but First Love Monster made up for it. Spoiler, you should watch that Dub Talk episode.
Because it was just recorded a few days before this
spoiler,
one.
Spoiler, we like to keep this part of the gym dry.
Oh, just this part.
Oh, Lord.
Not the part with Gigi in it. That part is permanently wet.
Fuck you.
Anyway. Good
when,
Lord.
Where, and how hard.
Anyway, I think we can definitely say that on the directing front, it's really solid. Like,
hell, like surprisingly solid.
Yeah. I would say even on the casting front, it's actually pretty solid too.
Yes, so. And the cheering is realistic, and I like it. Like, he does a really good job with the cheering. It's a good job. Yeah,
makes me wonder if Aaron was actually a cheerleader at one point in high school.
Oh my god.
Oh my
legit,
god.
Legit question for Dismuke. Did you cheerlead, boy? Boy, do you even cheerlead?
Do you have experience? Or maybe, like, I don't know if he maybe has.
Maybe his family, somebody in his family. Maybe his sister. Because I know, I believe Aaron has a sister, right?
Somewhere. I think he does, maybe? I don't know. It's like, one way or another, it feels kind of like he's like been in that world some way.
One way or another, we're gonna find out if you had a sister, Dismuke.
We're gonna one get you, get another, you, get you, get you.
Yes. One way or another.
All right. So overall, definitely solid. I would say directing. I think we're definitely in agreement with that.
Solid, just unlike Megan's poop.
What?
Solid, just like his. I always have abs. Sit down.
One made logical sense on Gigi's and the other, I'm like, what? Megan!
Solid. Solid. Unlike any alibis in Danganronpa.
Oh, Jesus Christ. This is so true. Anyway, I think we're good to move on into our actual cast.
Go to sleep, Nagi-kun!
It's not sleepy time yet. Anyway, so we're gonna start with, as of right now, the only female character of the show.
There's one other girl that our lead boy may be heterosexual for.
This is true. The only reason why we're not talking about her is I don't recall her name being, like, her ever introducing
I don't think
herself.
She actually has a name. I'm just gonna call her potentially straight.
So, well, there's in on the Anon casting list, there's a Chihiro Sakai. I don't know if that's the love interest or not.
Token girlfriend. Somebody's
token
gotta have
girlfriend.
One.
But anyway, we're gonna talk about Haruki Bando's sister, Haruko Bando. Such original names we got going on here. So, for Bando's sister, the story with her really is that she's really talented at judo. She won this competition in the women's category for, like, their school for the first time in, like, years. And clearly there's going to be some conflict between her and her brother when Haruki quits judo in college and decides to go to cheerleading. So, predictions for Haruko Bando. I had three.
I also had three, and mine were all wrong.
I had zero because I forgot there were girls in this anime.
Just I like don't every blame you.
Just like every other dumb talk I do. No, I'm just kidding.
It's like it's always about the guys.
It's only boys. Only boys.
Unless we get to a Kuroko episode in which I will actually have a small conniption over my wife, Riko Ida.
Anyway, Megan, do you want to go first?
Yes, because I had three predictions, all of them being wrong. My first prediction was, I just wrote mom.
we love you, Felicia Jill.
By the way, I love that. I hit 2,000 followers on Twitter. What questions do you have for me? How does it feel to be adopted by random strangers on the internet as her mother? She better answer that. I'm gonna be super upset if she doesn't. I think it was by likes, and I immediately stuck the entire crew on there.
Oh my god. Nice.
Thank you for doing a solid for me, G.
Welcome, boo. Welcome, boo.
My other predictions were Dawn Bennett and Colleen Quinkenbeard.
Colleen, that's an interesting one.
I don't know. I think I remember doing my predictions with you based off of just what the characters looked like.
Oh, yeah.
I pulled another Arslan.
I remember.
I pulled an Arslan. I legitimately did not watch the show for the first time until I got home from jury duty yesterday.
Oh, shit.
Yeah. So we were talking, like, I think it was a couple weeks ago before the announcement came up, and she was like, okay, what did you predict? What do these characters look like? And she would just pick things.
Hey, when I did it for Arslan, it worked.
Yeah, it kind of did, because you got, I think you got one or two right there.
I got Chris right, because I was a lazy sack of shit.
Anyway, the three that I have, I actually did predict Don Bennett as well, alongside Megan. My other two, though, I have Jeannie Tirado, and I also put Michaela Krantz as well.
Princess Mika.
I kind of stuck with the younger voice actresses. That's what I did. We're both wrong, though. So wrong.
Everybody's wrong. So,
yep. So, this name hasn't been brought up since Show Mean Sample.
Good God
Believe
Almighty.
It or not. So, of course, since Aaron directed Show Mean Sample, of course he brings her back here. We have Skylar Davenport coming in for Cheer Boys and voicing Bondo's older sister. She's still really, really new. You can count the amount of credits on, like, almost like on one hand. So she's had small roles in Boy and the Beast, Honda-kun, which we'll be talking about later on, One Piece, Puzzle and Dragons X, bleh, which is another broadcast dub, and then aside from Haruko, her only other major named character role was in Show Me Sample as Karen. Karen, if you don't remember, she is the sword-wielding goober who apparently, like, after having her clothes, like, stripped away in a stupid sword fight. I don't know. I don't remember that show that much, and I care not to.
You want to actively remember Show Mean Sample? Are you statistic?
No! Makes me glad I've never seen it.
It's a pile of
I know, isn't Show Mean Sample the reason why Hardy thinks Aaron Dismuke plays Hoonie Pop?
It might be.
I don't know.
I don't know what I've been told. Aaron Dismuke play Hentai Gold.
Anyway. How do we feel about Skylar Davenport as Haruko Bondo?
I think she's okay, I would say. I don't feel like we've gotten to know Haruko very much yet.
Yeah. I would say, like, with the first three, even four episodes, because originally when I watched the simulcast, I watched up to episode four, you don't really see her all that much. I have a feeling she's gonna play this kind of conflicting role against Haruki, her brother. So, but that's probably gonna happen a little bit later on, if anything. So, we don't hear much of her right now, but from what we've heard, I think it's actually pretty good. I mean, she's still fairly new, and I kind of liked it.
It could be a lot worse.
Yeah,
but it's also not that bad. I think, if anything, it's not the worst performance, but I don't think this dub is one with a lot of really, like, terrible performances.
No, I mean, the dub so far overall has been really rather solid all around.
Yeah, like, there's minute little things, right. But I don't think I think, if anything, it's just that I don't think we know the character enough yet to really get a good sense for her.
Right.
And that we'll get more of a sense for this character down the line.
Yeah, once we get the stereotypical supposed conflicting plot line. That's probably where we'll get a bit more from her. But as of right now,
sports anime are not the deepest thing on earth, guys.
No, it's really simple.
Oh, sorry.
I
thought it was okay. I mean, like, there was something, I remember something really annoying about the way that she talks, but there's annoying shit about the way that I talk, so I'm gonna give her a pass for the moment.
Alright, yeah, we'd have to hear a lot, have to see the character a lot more to really get a better idea, but pretty good start as of right now, I would say. So we think we want to move on from there?
Yeah, can we talk about boys again? Sorry.
Boys!
Oh, absolutely. So we have... There's seven boys that we meet in the first three episodes that join the Breakers, the Cheer Boys. Four of them are going to be paired off together. So the first pair, Soichiro Suzuki, a.k.a. Ichido, and Gen Hasegawa.
Best boy!
So these two, initially, they come in, I think it's episode two, I think.
Yeah.
Wait, what are their names again? I don't...
It's the slutty dude and the dickbag.
No, that's the problem. What are there? Is one of them named Yu?
No. Ichido and Gen.
Do I not have a... I don't think I have a prediction for Ichido.
I don't know. I think you ought to. Because these two characters, we meet them initially in the second episode. And they originally had joined the tennis team. The tennis club.
To pick up bitches.
Yes!
Yeah! And then they basically become convinced by the other four guys that were currently on the cheer squad to join to pick up chicks.
God love them.
Basically. Oh, Lord. Predictions for these two? What did I have? I had one for Ichido, and then I had three for Gen.
I had two for each, my thing is, but I got them all wrong.
I don't know if I have them, because I think I might have mistaken them for somebody else. Like I said, I was not familiar with the whole cast.
Gen is the slutty boy, and Ichiro is like the frat boy dickhead.
That explains a lot, Gigi.
Just saying. That's what I wrote down.
Hold on, let me see if I can help you out here.
I'm gonna need a lot of help.
Gen has me. Long red hair. Okay, long red hair. Ichiro has like the sort of buzz cut, and it's a dark. He's got dark hair.
That one time Megan actually needs help in the episode.
It's like, I don't care.
If I need to, I just don't. Who the fuck is you? Who the fuck is you then?
I don't know who you is. Okay, I don't have him down at
all.
I
don't know who you is.
Cheer boys, what's? I have Hasegawa.
Okay, so there's Hasegawa right there.
Okay, are you Skyping these to me?
I am
sharing. Okay, she's so literally hot. Pulled up my anime list.
Okay, Hasegawa. And then... Where are you? There you are.
Okay, no, I did not make a prediction, but I can make lie and say I did. I'm gonna lie and say I did.
Okay.
And I probably thought he was Rico.
Oh my god. Stop it.
There is no character named you, by the way. I'm looking at this
right now. Who the hell did I think that's who I thought it was then?
It might have been.
Oh my god! I thought that's who that was. I'm an idiot, guys.
It's cool.
Megan Zarek, professional anime podcaster.
We got this, guys. It's alright. Okay, so back to predictions for these two. So Gigi had two of each, I had one for Ichido and three for Gen, and Megan, now that we know...
I have three for the one guy, and I have, I have four for the other one.
Okay.
Oh no, I have three and then three, but I was wrong on both, but I actually had the right person for Hasegawa in the wrong place.
Oh!
This lovely. Is like a weird circle of fuck right now.
Okay. It's the circle of fuck.
All right, who wants to go first with their predictions?
I guess I will, since I caused a small train wreck.
choo choo! Okay, oh, here it is again.
What do you got?
That damn train never gets out.
What do you have, Megan?
Choo choo. I had for you, or not you?
Ichido.
Sonichiro. I had Eric Vale, Clifford Chapin, maybe Ian Sinclair, or John Luke Hester.
I'm just gonna throw this out there. My sole prediction for Ichido was Ian Sinclair.
Of course, one of my predictions for Ichido was my husbando Ian Sinclair.
Woo!
Three for three, guys! Woo!
Typical Ian Sinclair.
And then like my predictions for Hasegawa were Joel McDonald, maybe Justin Briner, and Eric Vale.
Okay, I have to join you with Joel McDonald. That was one of my predictions for Hasegawa.
I just high-fived myself to make myself feel better.
My other two predictions for Hasegawa, I actually put Jason Lebrecht and Chris Patton in there as well.
Oh.
Chris Patton, mostly because he did come in for Princess Stride, which Caitlin directed. So I kind of figured if Caitlin was a director, maybe she'll pull him here, if possible. And then Jason, he was in Princess Stride. I thought it was pretty decent, though to be fair, I still need to finish the dub. but
yeah, don't still. Watch the second episode. Ugh, don't do it.
The second to the last episode makes absolutely no sense.
Oh god, it killed it.
Oh lord.
Oh, hey, do you care if I spoil it, Lila?
Maybe we should not spoil Prince of Stride.
I don't care. But
don't worry, we'd all forget about it by the time we got to high school anyway.
Oh, that bit. Oh,
that
lord.
Bit.
I remember that. Gigi, fuck. What were your predictions for these two?
Alright, well, for my best boy, Gen, who's clearly King Slut, because I love him, and I don't remember...
Ian Sinclair!
No, not him, actually. I don't remember why I wrote this, probably because of either Dance with Devils or Prince of Stride or Show by Rock.
Oh, good God.
I did Aaron Roberts, and I also did Rico Fajardo.
Nice.
My boy.
Yep. And then for Ichiro, who is like third best boy, but I don't care because he's a dick frat boy. So I put Ian Sinclair, the love of my life. And in odd, strange casting, just in case he didn't direct, I put Aaron Dismuke.
Nice. Okay.
Aaron Dismuke's gonna show up as like the villain because all he wants to do is play an irrevocably evil human being. He's like, I hate it every time I play a bad guy. They always end up being secretly good.
I think I heard him at one point as a background character, maybe like the first or second episode. But anyway, so we're all wrong. Ooh. Megan was close. So Ichino Suzuki. Here's a name that I think has only been brought up once. Alejandro Saab is so.
Isn't
Ichino
that Andrew's
Suzuki.
Like best fucking friend?
He's the one who originally brought it up, actually, a while ago. And as for Gen Hasegawa, this is where Megan was rather close. It's actually Clifford Chapin.
Out of fucking left field with this. Like, I just can't. I can't get behind it. I mean, I can, but I can't. But sorry, continue.
In terms of additional roles that these two have been in, Alejandro Saab is still actually fairly new. He's originally from Team 4-Star, though, I think, right?
I think he was doing a bridge stuff online, yes.
I have no idea.
I'm learning about him now, too, okay? So, in terms of other roles that he has done, he's been in Assassination Classroom, Degashi Kashi, Dance with Devils, Fairy Tale 2, My Hero Academia, One Piece, Princess Stride Alternative, Seraph of the End, Battle of Nagoya, and Yon of the Dawn, but those are background roles. He does have named roles in 3 broadcast dubs this season, including Cheer Boys.
And he's in another show, DVD-wise, I think. Oh, no, wait, that's somebody else. Never mind.
But oopsies. The other two, not going to say which characters, because episodes aren't going to happen. He's also
one of them happens Thursdays.
Yeah, one of them anyway. One, he does have a named role in Honda-kun, and he also has a named role in Servamp. So he's in 3 broadcast subs this season. So good on you, first of all, sir. In terms of Clifford Chapin, you've heard him, or at least us, talk about him a lot.
We have all mispronounced his name.
I'm just rather glad I'm actually getting it right for a change. I haven't fucked it up yet. I'm sorry, Clifford, I love you, but I'm sorry.
Love you, boo.
I'm sorry for screwing up your name. Other roles that Clifford Chapin has been involved with, of course, Assassination Classroom, Attack on Titan. He is in Barakamon. He is in Defrag, Divine Gate, Gangsta. Good lord, we're not going to talk about Gangsta.
Oh, you will never be over that, will you?
No. Yon of the Dawn, Yon of the Dawn, Heroic Legend of Arslan, My Hero Academia is Bakugo. He was recently announced in Overlord, which I would love to do an episode for that eventually.
He's also in Servamp somewhere.
Yes. Servamp somewhere, Princess Stride, Alternative Prison School, Psychopass 2, oh lord, Snow White with the Red Hair, Tokyo Ghoul is Hide, of course.
Talk to me about that.
We're not gonna talk about Hide. And a variety of other things.
Wait. Did you say that Clifford Chapin was the asshole blonde kid in My Hero Academia?
Yes!
Shut the fuck up, are you kidding?
No! That's him!
Holy shit!
Did you not realize that was him?
No, it doesn't sound anything like him.
Oh, to me it sounds like him, but
I've heard him a lot, actually.
That was really good, though. But anyway, in terms of Alejandro Saab and Clifford Chapin's performances in the dub so far, how do we feel about them?
Well, my good buddy Ichiro, he's like a frat boy with a heart. And he's not bad. Like, he's kind of a dick, but I don't think he's an asshole enough. So, Alejandro, work on your assholeness.
I think the other thing is, like, that it kind of goes into the third episode.
He's a dick with a heart of gold.
Yeah, he's an asshole without, but he doesn't really mean it. It's like
asshole.
It's like he has the whole insert foot and mouth syndrome going on there. So I feel like that's the kind of thing that they're going with, and it actually works. And for me, this is my technically my second, because I have been watching Honda-kun. My first or second go around with Alejandro Saab in a role, and I kind of like it, actually.
Oh, I love it. I was like, wow, you're like not dicky enough for me, but I still love it. Like, he does a really good frat
boy. Yeah, it's still really good, and I actually really enjoy it. Of course, I'm watching the other show that he's in, and I'm a little more like, gotta get used to that character. Was not expecting that.
Yeah, and I mean, his character in Honda-kun too, completely different than what he's playing here. So, two different spectrums that I'm seeing right now, and I really like this role as of right now. Again, he's a bit of a dick. Insert, like, foot and mouth syndrome going on here. But I do like it. As for Clifford, though...
Oh my God.
I don't know, actually.
I thought he was unrecognizable. Like, legitimately unrecognizable.
Oh no, I could recognize... I could pick up, like...
Yeah, like, I knew that was Cliff the second he walked in.
Yeah.
I was, like, not at all slutty. Not slutty enough. That's what I wrote down. Do you need lessons? I will teach you.
Oh, God damn it.
Gigi slut lessons, sign up today.
$69 an hour.
Whoa.
$69.69 an hour.
Ooh, classy.
Oh, boy. Me, I'm kind of iffy on it, but that's more because I saw him in a different character type than where he is.
Yeah, I put him somewhere else, too, actually.
Yeah. I'll admit this right now. I had him.
I had him in a couple of. I actually had him in two other different slots, besides the one I obviously guessed.
Yeah, like it's iffy to me. Like I can see it working. I just need a little bit more time.
You know the part where he did that little heart to heart talk with Haru, and I was like, okay, that is why girls will fall in love with you. But I was like, okay, I get it now. Like, once he had that talk, I was like, okay, you're in.
Yeah. It's like, it took a minute for me to, like, kind of adjust and, like, really get into the performance. But I think it's growing on me. It's just taking a little bit longer compared to all the other performances. So I don't want to call it the weakest right now, but it's the one that's taking the longest to really grow on me, I would say.
Listen, I like him. I like the character, but at the same time, I feel like it's like, oh, hey, Cliff's in this show. Yay! Cliff's in this show!
And he's this character!
Oh my God, I have a leg cramp.
It's like a dog tilting its head. Like...
Oh my God! That is the best analogy right there. I love that.
I mean, like, compared to, like, Princess Stride, where he's Hozumi?
Oh my God, though, that was the best.
Okay, like, I like when Cliff gets to do characters like that, or, like, absolute assholes like Bakugo. Like, Cliff is really good at playing dicks.
He really is, actually.
Cliff is, like, that's, like, the one things I like, is, like, I always say this, I'm like, I want to see Clifford Chapin playing more a-holes. I want to see Micah Solisad playing more psychos. Thursday's going to be fun.
Oh Lord.
And I really want to see Rico Fajardo playing more spazzes.
Oh God damn it.
Please stop. For the love of God, Funimation, I know Rico's really good at playing really stoic emo kids. Like Itona and
Daryun.
Daryun and Fire Armor McSour plus My Mom is Dead.
God damn it.
And like, Captain, all my friends are dead, but at least I have a bitch in Trident. Like, I like that Rico gets to play that, but I also really want to see Rico play a knucklehead mixed Bazatron. For all of you who get that reference.
Well, admittedly, then, like, Princess Stride was a nice breath of fresh air there for Rico, though.
Well, no, even then, his character in Prince of Stride was essentially Haru on land.
Well,
he was Landru. He was Landru.
His humor was still so deadpan, though, and I loved it.
But he's always, like, the deadpan. Like, so, like, in this case, like, I would have really liked to see, like, Dismuke and Cliff play, like, some huge motherfucking dickwads.
Oh, that would have been good.
Oh, that would have been great.
I mean, other than his heart being in his actual penis.
Oh, god.
See, all he's done is join the cheer boys to get some pussy, but, maybe he'll learn to love women for as they are because he's doing cheerleading. I don't know. I mean, I'm happy he's in the show, but would I have liked him to play a different character? Maybe, but I'm not upset that he's there. So yeah. Let's just talk about Best Boy.
We already did. His name is Gen.
No, it's not. That's not how you spell Ton.
Oh my god. Girl, we're gonna have to have words.
Oh lord.
Ton is a ton to love.
Girls, ladies, calm down for like a second. So the consensus I'm getting from these two, Alejandro Saab, we're liking it right now. Clifford Chapin, it's gonna take a little bit more time to really get into it. Cause one, it's not what we what we expected. And two, going from like assholey characters like Bakugo last season to this, it's a kind of a drastic change, honestly. But anyway, so the other pair we're going to be talking about, let's see, Wataru Mizuguchi and Koji Tono. So Wataru Mizuguchi, I have to say the line, which by the way, I really wish I knew who the scriptwriter was for this. My name is Wataru Mizuguchi. I am 20 years old and I'm a freshman business student. I have no friends.
No, my favorite part with Wataru is when he's drunk.
Oh my god. I'll be right back. You guys,
Wataru, what's at the bottom? No, it's the only one who understands me! Scene where he gets super, super shit-faced is great. That and the explanation about the squirrels.
That was amazing. He's like the best way I can probably describe Wataru is this freaking awkward turtle.
Wataru is like the drunk son of Rico's character from Prince of Stride and Ray from Free.
God damn it. Oh, that slightly influences
he's like,
my prediction.
He's
there.
Like Ray's dorkier son.
Oh my god.
Okay. Canon, this is taking place in the future of the Free universe.
Oh my god. So, and then the other character, Koji Tono, he comes in the second episode. He's a bit on the larger side in terms of the guys. But he decides to join the men's cheerleading team because he wanted to do some sort of change with himself. So that's really cool. I like that. Prediction-wise, I had two for each, but I did get Tono right.
I also got Tono right, but I had four predictions for Tono, and I had two predictions for Wataru. One of them you should be able to see coming from a mile away.
Low-hanging fruit. Okay.
I will also say this because Hardy wanted me to repeat this on recording.
Okay.
Ton is not a sweet cinnamon roll too pure for this earth. He's a sweet meatloaf too pure and good for this earth.
Oh my god, I love
Gigi,
that!
I feel like we lost Gigi.
I think she said she had to, do something for, like, a second.
Gigi, where'd you go? Gigi!
What? Sorry, I, like,
Gigi, I'm lost without you!
I'm seriously sitting here doing jumping jacks because I have a fucking leg cramp.
Oh no!
I'm picking my
Gigi, I was lost without you!
Oh no!
Gigi, I was lost without you.
What happened? Were you talking about drunk people?
Yes, oh, actually!
We're sorry. We're talking about Wataru for a second.
Oh my god, then, you mean J. Michael Tatum?
Ow!
And the low-hanging
fruit. Ow! My Showbar Rock headphones just snapped back and hit me in the finger.
Oh my god damn it.
Okay, real talk, let's talk about this for a second. So y'all have Loot Crate, right?
Yes.
Did you get the music Loot Crate with the little Show by Rock headphones?
Yes, they are the still only in good the packaging.
Part about that Loot Crate.
Mother of God, these things are so short. Like, you can't even, like, get, like, 5 inches away from your computer. Otherwise, they'll snap back and give you a fucking concussion.
Anyway, predictions for Wataru and Tono.
Wataru, exact wording, Tatum or nothing bitches, maybe Todd.
Those are the two that I put, actually. Because, of course, J. Michael Tatum, low-hanging fruit. It's a glasses character. He's rather dorky and awkward. I'm just like,
I said, drunk baby of Ray and that guy from Enrico's character from Princess Stride.
And
God
then,
bless.
And then I had Todd Haberkorn as my backup because I actually really enjoyed his performance from Shonen Maid. So I was like, I can kind of see this working. I would love to see an awkward Todd. That'd be fantastic.
I didn't know that this character got drunk, and as we all know, drunk Uncle Todd is best Uncle Todd. If Grimgar Fantasy and Ash didn't tell us, I knew nothing about that character in Grimgar Fantasy and Ash other than him being drunk like 24/7.
Yeah. Gigi, what did you have for predictions for Wataru aside from Tatum?
You mean there's another? No, I actually stole from Princess Stride and put Micah Salasad.
Nice.
Oh, baby.
Wouldn't that be funny? I think that would be funny.
Are you a baby? All right. I got so mad that he got hurt. No lie. I'm a leaf. Okay. So when that episode happened on Facebook, Micah posted that picture and he just put, "I'm a leaf on the wind, watch how I soar." And I'm like, the last time somebody said that to me, it didn't wash out very well.
Oh. Wow. Okay, so Koji Tono.
It left me without a sense of serenity.
Alright, so Koji Tono.
I mean, he went out like a firefly.
I'm about to say, Koji Tono, I had two predictions. I got this correct. My other prediction was Tyson Reinhardt.
I had two.
I mean, I had a river of tears down my face.
What did you say, Megan?
Nothing. I was making more bad firefly puns.
Gigi, what did you have for Koji Tono?
I have Derek Snow, and I don't know why because I don't remember who he is.
Derek Snow, that name is familiar.
And then I put Cliff Chapin.
Okay, so.
I had
Snow. He was the Pomeranian from Dance with Devils.
That's why I put him.
Ba-da-ba-da.
That's who it is. He's that guy.
I
can't think of the Pomeranian from Dance with Devils, thanks to Shannon.
Because
you put it the Pomeranian choir to fucking Dog of Wisdom. So every time I hear about the Pomeranian from Dance with Devils, all I hear is ba-da-ba-da, ba-da-ba-da-da-da. I just keep on hearing them sing Walking on Air.
Oh my god.
And Megan, who did you have for
Cliff? I had four predictions. At least three of them got jossed. My predictions were Phil Parsons, Tyson Reinhardt, and Jeremy Inman.
Okay. So the individuals voicing these characters. I'm going to start with Koji Tono, because Megan and I did get this correct. It's actually Chris George.
Yay!
It's Koji Tono. Now, Wataru, however...
did not see this fucking coming.
No! No one probably did. And admittedly, when I originally saw the name on the press release, I'm like, what? Really? Really? So the individual voicing Wataru is Jared Green.
I don't know who that is.
Oh,
I know who that is, but I'm not remembering anything he does right now.
Okay, but we'll go over a few things in a second. So for Chris George, some roles you've probably heard him in. We have Appleseed 13, excuse me. I can't read Norman numerals today. He's really mostly done background roles. And he was an ADR engineer first.
Doesn't Chris George at one point in season 2 of Snow White with the Red Hair replace Eric Fale?
Yes, he is the director for Snow White with the Red Hair.
Oh. Oh, good God, Chris George, I love you to death, but dear Jesus, boy.
some named...
He also... This episode's gonna be out by then, right?
I have no idea.
This is the motherfucker who directed Netoje, right?
Yes.
Chris George, I don't know... I know you're not listening, but good sir, if I ever meet you in real life, I owe you a beer. throw you the stiffest drink.
That fucking shit.
Dear Christ almighty, man.
Okay, but going back to his voice acting work, he's had named roles in Appleseed 13, Dime a Dollar, let's see, Enride.
Penguin Dicks. Was he one of the Penguin Dicks?
Probably.
Penguin Dicks.
He was in Fairy Tale, in Fairy Tale Zero. He's so also everybody. In Yomengand, My Hero Academia. It's two roles, actually. Princess Stride Alternative, Shakugan Roshanma 3, and then the rest are either minor or background characters. But you probably heard us talk about him more rather as a director than voice acting work. In terms of Jared Green. I almost said someone else's name that we're going to get to in a second here. My bad. Jared Green, he's working his way up there in terms of credits. So he has a lot of background roles, but some named characters. He's Genji from Divine Gate. He's Yang from Gangsta. He's Moguzo from Grimgar Fantasy and Ash. That's probably one of the
Moguzo!
Biggest roles. Probably his biggest, one of his larger roles to date. He's Kishwar from Heroic Legend of Arslan. Sato from Level E. Rintaro from Noreen. Subaru from Robotics Note. Reiji from Tokyo Ravens, yep. Coco from Toriko. And Seijiro Nanami from Ultimate Otaku Teacher. Nope. So. Nothing that Gigi recognizes.
Nothing at all, sorry.
I knew Moguzo because I loved the shit out of his performance in Grimgar.
Yep, Grimgar Arslan and Ultimate Otaku Teacher are probably the three that I know him from as of right now. But in terms of the performances, how do we feel about these two?
Oh my god.
Okay, so Jared, buddy, pal, you are not the hero that we deserve. But by God, you beautiful bastard! You are the hero that we need.
Yes.
I at first, because okay, here's the thing going into it. I went to the first episode, and to be fair, the first episode of this show bored the shit out of me.
Yeah,
yeah.
It takes a little bit.
Boring as balls. Until this goober shows up.
Oh my God!
And just invites himself. Into another man's house. I mean, I don't know how college works in Japan.
But I lived in a
dorm for 4 years.
Oh my
that shit
God.
Don't fucking fly. First
no.
of all, one, where the fuck were the RAs?
Oh my God.
I don't think they're living in a dorm.
Second,
no, Cosmo,
you know shut up, I
Cosmo's
can
in an apartment, I think. Cosmo's
live,
in
like,
an apartment.
Home.
Oh yeah, and his parents are dead because Tragic showed a backstory.
Yeah.
But, At first, I was like, episode one was like, okay. Then he got drunk.
Then
Wataru got drunk and Tan showed up. And then the Tan and Wataru fun fiesta began.
Oh my God. Besties for life.
Jared Green, I don't know you. I want to meet you. And when I meet people and they've impressed me on the internet doing anime, I try to buy them alcohol. God knows I owe Mike McFarland a lot of alcohol.
Oh my God.
Jared Green, I want to see you as drunk as Wataru.
Oh my God. Oh,
also,
be very
also,
careful, Jared. Be very careful if you ever meet Megan at a convention.
Look here,
she
look,
will
look,
get
look,
you
look
drunk.
Here. Okay, anybody who meets me, we're playing Sarah for the drink and you can't stop me.
Oh, God damn
you
it.
Will be toast. Your liver will be deader than half the characters in Sarah for the End.
Oh.
And Full Metal Alchemist combined.
Oh, Lord. So, before we shift to Tan for a second, like I was kind of saying before with Wataru. When I saw the press release and I saw Jared Green's name attached to Wataru, I was not sure how to feel. I did not know
how
to feel.
Was this another picture of a dog tilting its head and making an ear?
Yeah.
An ear incomprehensible screech noise?
Basically. I wasn't sure how to feel about it. I was like, because I was picturing Moguzo and Kishwar and all a few other roles that he's done, and I'm like, I don't feel like that's gonna fit. And then you just throw him into the show and let him go for like 20 minutes, and I'm like, okay, I'm good. We're sold. Because he's the most awkward turtle I've ever seen. recently, and it is glorious, and I love it.
Oh, I love him so much.
It's so perfect. He's such a socially awkward person.
I wrote down
that again.
I just want Jared Green and Watcher's voice now to say, I like turtles.
You guys.
Oh my god.
You guys, he's the best phone guy ever. Just saying. Like, he could narrate any trailer and I'd be like, here's $13. Please take my money. Will you hold my hand in the back and we can eat Raisinets? I don't know where I am right
hell?
Now. But also, I thought he was really creepy, which means it's amazing because, you know, I like things creepy. So, ugh.
Yeah, I'm just like, yep, I'm sold.
We're in.
I love it.
We're
so in. And as for Ton, oh god, I actually like it. I really like Chris George.
Ton, besides being best boy.
No.
Because there's more to love. is the cutest, most adorable sounding fat guy I've ever met. And I really just want to love him and hug him, and I want his little meat shirt. His little shirt that has the little meat thing on it. Like, Chris George makes him sound so adorable and yet so believable in his, like, fat guy conviction. Because I also like the fact that he doesn't have, like, a stereotypical, like, slobby voice. He just sounds like a normal person.
That's exactly what I thought. He's very sincere.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that's a really hard thing to translate in your voice. Mm. Sincerity is incredibly hard to get across.
Yeah, it can be really difficult. But, like, here's the other interesting thing, because the seiyuu who voices Ton is Yu Hayashi. So going from, what has Mr. Hayashi done? Tanaka from Haikyuu.
Wait, what?
Ogiwara from Kuroko's Basket 3.
No. Go back. Excuse me?
I'm not kidding you.
No. Are you kidding me?
I'm not kidding you.
What the fuck?
And Megan lost her shit.
And Megan's done. R.I.P.
Yeah,
Megan,
he was the seiyuu for Tona. So going from his vocal range to Chris George, not only is the tone of voice completely different,
yeah,
but in terms of the personality and everything, they both work really well.
Okay, no, and what?
Yeah.
Okay, no, even then, you brought up Kuroko, which I know. He's, shit, Gigi's not in that season yet.
No,
fuck.
Sorry.
I don't want to spoil it.
No,
I don't want to spoil that character.
Don't.
I don't want to spoil who that character is, because that character is such a big part of... He's in a small part of the third season, but he's a really big influence on the show. Also, B, if you're listening to this and you haven't watched Kuroko's Basketball, please go watch Kuroko's Basketball, because it's such a good anime. I don't know why everyone thinks I'm high for liking it. It's such a good show. I don't care if it's 75 episodes of only subbed anime. It's going to get dubbed eventually. We're going to do a podcast. The two of you are going to be in it. You're going to watch it eventually, Steph. I'm going to hold you down.
Megan, breathe.
No, I can't breathe. We're talking about sports. Anime.
Oh, cheerleading's a sport.
I mean, like, there's so many things. Ah!
But anyway.
Remember, we're not perverts. We're cheer boys.
Yes. But going back to Chris George, I agree. Like, it's really hard to come across as, like, a genuine, sincere character. And Chris George, I love him as Tono.
Yeah, he's very
good.
I
really like him.
He's
yeah,
very good.
I think, like, the majority of the casting that we've seen so far, a lot of it is actually lesser-known voice actors that don't get major roles all that often. So far, Clifford Chapin is probably the only one on the cast that has had, like, larger roles. Jared Green is getting up there, too, because he did do Mogazo recently. But Alejandro Saab,
he's the only person
George
on the cast so far doing major role that we've announced so far.
So far.
Because there are other people who have.
There's at least one big one that we're going to get to eventually, and then the other two, kind of. But in terms of overall for Tono and Well, true. I'm sold. We're good.
I'm in.
I'm in. We're good. So we good to move
this
on?
This upsets me. This upsets me that he's the voice of... This upsets me. No, I need to now go back through the other ones.
Oh my god.
No. Now we're doing this. You've opened this bag. This is all your fault.
I'm sorry.
Oh god.
You've turned this into part say you talk.
While you do that, how about we,
I got Hasegawa's already.
Oh god damn it. How about we, move on to Sho Takugawa, while you're going through,
Oh good god.
Faux show.
Say you stuff.
Faux show.
Okay.
No.
Sho Takugawa, he's first introduced in the third episode. It's clear.
Squirrel Man!
It is clear that he has done some sort of cheerleading before. It's clear from the get-go. Because he does know a lot about acrobatics and safety precautions and a variety of things.
Oh good god, this one's actually going to be funny for Gigi, the one I have up already. Because it's Cliff's character.
What? Okay.
And in the Japanese, not only is he, Amon from Tokyo Ghoul Route A and Gakuto from Prison School.
Oh god damn it.
It gets so much better from here.
Oh god.
He's also Kenji Kazuma from Defrag.
He's Haji. He's Haji from Blood Plus.
Know who else he is, Gigi?
Ooh.
He's Reiji Sakamaki. From Diabolic Club.
Oh, fuck!
Yes! I knew it! I knew I had a reason for living, and this is that moment.
This is why I was put on this earth.
This is why we're friends.
I can't
this
find anybody for Suzuki. We already went over Koji. Wataru should be pretty funny. Wataru is gonna be good. I just have to go quickly down to the bottom of 2016. Okay, so Wataru, not only, oh my god, Wataru gets so much better! Okay, so not only is the guy who plays Wataru is also Karasuma in Assassination Classroom.
What?
Yes! He's Gintoki in Gintama, he's Etsuya in Food Wars.
Oh my god.
Okay.
He is, I'm trying to find anime that we've watched, that's why. Oh, good god. He's Brock in Pokemon Origins? What the shit?
Wow.
Okay.
He's Akira in... He's the guy with the duck in Suritama.
Oh my god.
Oh, good god. So who are we on now?
Sho Tokugawa.
Okay, so in the Japanese, not only is Sho Tokugawa is also the love of your life from, is Josuke from JoJo's Bizarre Adventure.
No, wait, I haven't seen that one yet. Okay, keep going.
He's Isami from Food Wars.
Okay.
He's Hori from Monthly Girls Nozaki-kun.
What?
Yes. And he's Asia from The Devil is a Part-Timer.
Oh, Asiel. Oh my god.
Asiel.
Nice.
And then, of course, he's my boy. He's me and Gigi's boy, Kagami, from Kuroko's Basketball.
Bless.
I love you. Oh my god, he also can sing really well.
Okay, I'm fangirling now. Let's continue.
Legit at Yomacon, we are totally watching Kuroko's Cup. I don't fucking care.
Right, reeling it back in a bit.
I don't care what we say, we are still watching Kuroko's Cup. I'm making the boys watch it too.
Oh god. So, Sho Tokugawa, introduced in the third episode, clearly he's had some sort of past experience as a cheerleader of some kind, and he loves squirrels? Question mark?
Who wouldn't love squirrels?
He loves squirrels. The love is real.
But, so, predictions for Sho Tokugawa. I only had two, actually.
He's a little nutty.
I had
three. I got them all wrong.
I got it wrong.
I had four, and I got them all wrong, I believe.
We're really doing a great job at this, ladies.
Yeah, we're doing fantastic.
I don't know. I may have gotten this right, and if I say it and I accidentally got it right, just smack me through the internet. Or I'll yell for my mom to come whack me upside the head.
Okay. How about we save you for last for a second then? Gigi, why don't you go first?
Show is very deadpan, and so of course I had to put Jerry Jewell in there. because Jerry Jewell is king of deadpan. And then because he's also a smarmy motherfucker, I put Vic Mignogna in there. And then I put Chris Burnett, but I don't remember who he is.
Romeo from Romeo's Juliet.
I don't know.
You raise me up.
Wait, was he?
No.
Yeah, he's Romeo.
Yes, we went. Gigi, we went over this Friday.
Oh, that's why I put him down.
Anyway, my
Gigi, we just went over this.
Listen, okay. I'm tired and all I've done today is drink Starbucks.
Okay, my two predictions for show, I had, because deadpan, of course, I went with Rigo Fajardo as one, because Princess Stride is a thing that exists. And I also went with Dave Matranga, actually, as my other choice for a show. Now, Megan, what do you have?
Okay, so, for show Tokugawa, who may have a nut loose, I had Growly McGrowlpants.
Dave Matranga, thanks. Great. Going back
I gotta have you remember that at every waking moment.
Oh, God damn it.
I'm literally just gonna bring, like, something that I can record that on my phone, and while Noah's asleep at Yomacon, play it behind his ear to wake him up every morning.
Oh my god. He would kill you.
Jenny would find it funny.
Jenny would find it funny, but what else do you have?
Micah Solisad, Dallas Reed, or Jason Lebrecht?
You did not get it correct.
Thank God, because I was gonna feel really dumb.
Okay. So, none of us got this correct. So, the person who's voicing Sho Tokugawa is actually, he's not new, but he's having a lot more major roles lately. He's also doing a lot more directing, too. So, we have Kyle Phillips as Sho Tokugawa.
Oh yeah, that's right!
So, you might have...
You told me this before.
Yeah, I told you this like an hour ago.
And I completely forgot.
Okay. So
I'm an idiot.
So, other roles that you might have heard him in, he's in Assassination Classroom. He is in another broadcast dub this season, Disastrous Life of Saki K, which I believe the guys are actually recording that episode at the same time as us recording this one.
Our recording is better.
Duh.
He's also in High School DxD. He is Denki from My Hero Academia. He is in Princess...
Oh my god, he's my love!
Yep, he's in Princess Stride. He's in Rage of Bahamut Genesis as Hamsa the Goose slash Duck. And he's also in Three Leaves, Three Colors. Those are at least the major named roles that he has. He has a variety of background roles. Again, you've mostly heard us talk about him a lot recently, more with directing. So he's also the director for Degashikashi, Dance with Devils, Enride. He's actually, I don't want to say that, actually, because we got to save that. And Ultimate Otaku Teacher is another directing position that he has. So, how do we feel about Kyle Phillips as a show?
I think it's okay.
I thought he was very monotone.
Yeah.
Like, he's a very weak villain.
He's not even supposed to be a villain, though.
I mean, but, like, in the parts where he's supposed to be, like, an asshole, like, I felt it was very monotone. And, like, very weak. But when he starts talking about them squirrels, though.
But
that squirrel, though. I, like, okay, I don't know who plays the old guy who runs the
He's shop. Funny.
That guy is a riot. But I love this one thing where he's like, sure, you can have them. I have another set. Also, you're kind of creepy.
That was the best.
I was like, that kind of like explains it perfectly.
That was the best. Like, personally, because I'm slowly learning about Kyle Phillips as a voice actor, not just director now, which is awesome, first of all. Because I'm going off of Hamsa from Rage of Bahamut and Denki from My Hero Academia. The show is a very different role than what he's tackled.
Denki was a lot better done, and that was a small, much smaller character.
Yeah, I Denki left a much bigger impression than Sho. But I will agree, I kind of like it, though. It's interesting, it is a different kind of character than he's voiced, at least to me, anyway. And I'll agree, it was rather monotone for the majority of it, but then when he actually, like, gives a lot of life and energy with the whole squirrel obsession thing, for instance, it really works.
Yeah.
I want to say that Kyle Phillips is in an episode, is in Assassination Classroom.
He is.
Kids.
He is.
At least he's artist kid.
Sosuke Sugaya.
Yes, he is artist kid.
Yeah. So, I think I really enjoy Kyle Phillips more when he has so much energy, like, these energetic characters. But, at the same time, he's, as far as I know of as of right now, he's much more closed off and has a lot of walls. Again, there's clearly something else there, and it's probably going to be a plotline in the series. So, I feel like once that stereotypical plotline happens, he's probably going to warm up a lot more. And he probably will get to relax with it a bit, but we'll have to wait and see on that.
I hope so. I hope he gets a little bit nuttier.
Oh, God. And with that, we should probably move on. on that joke. So, we're down to our final two. First, we have Kazuma Hashimoto. I'll admit, this is my favorite guy as of right now. So, Kazuma is basically the reason and the person who starts the men's cheerleading club. Because...
I hate myself right now for who I predicted to cast.
Me too. But just let's go. Let's do this.
But, he started the men's cheerleading club kind of to follow in his mother and his dad's footsteps. Because his mother was a cheerleader in college and his dad was actually a cheerleading coach. At the same school, and that's how his parents met. Also, tragic backstory, his parents are dead, and he has a grandma in the hospital, yada yada yada.
Parents are dead.
Yep, and he's also best friends with Haruhi Bando. He's been best friends with them essentially since his parents died when he was, like, in elementary school. But he is the main reason why cheerleading, why this show is happening, why this is a thing. So, predictions for Kazuma, I had three.
I had two.
I cannot believe my three predictions.
Do you want to get yours out of the way?
I'm kind of terrified now.
No, there's a story behind it.
That's why I'm thinking, I'm asking if you want to get yours out of the way before you
Just do it now. Okay, so because we've been talking about all the saviors that go along with this, so I did this unintentionally, completely unintentionally, by the way. So, in the Japanese, Kazuma is played by Nobuhiko Okamoto, who has played characters like Usui in Maid-sama, Rin in Blue Exorcist.
I just found one in particular.
He is also a lot of other very, just to give some other various characters. He's also Noya in Noya in Haikyuu.
Best boy.
The most hilarious one is that he's Yoichi in Seraph of the End.
Bye.
He's also Obi in
Snow White.
He's Obi in Snow White.
Bye.
So, but
and yeah.
My predictions were, but he's also Takaru Fujiwara, who is Rika Fajardo in English, who I predicted. He's Karma in Assassination Classroom, who I predicted Tyndall for this. But the kicker, he's Bakugo.
Oh, fuck.
And I predicted Clifford. And I predicted literally the last three roles he's done.
Oh my god.
As three kids.
That is amazing.
Wow.
This is just, mother of god, I'm a dumbass.
So, I'm gonna have to join you on at least two of your predictions, because I also had Austin Tyndall and Clifford Chapin for Cosmo.
Wow.
But I will also say that my third pick, and the one I actually put as my first choice, was Micah Solasad. That was my other one. Gigi, what do you have, Gigi, for predictions for Cosmo?
I just wanted Prince of Stride, and I just wanted Prince of Stride. So I picked Garrett Storms, who's my Prince of Stride boyfriend, also my Dance with Devils boyfriend, because hello, pink hair. Pink hair, and then you look at Kazuma.
Did you really pick the human Garmin?
Yes. Don't talk to me. And then I also picked my mortal enemy, Jason Lebrecht.
Oh, god damn it.
My angel and my... So, essentially... Gigi, you have not seen Seraph of the End.
I've only
all the way
seen
through
episode...
Yet,
up to episode 5.
You know that Garrett Storms is essentially Japanese anti-vampire Hitler, right?
No.
Oh, she'll learn then soon enough.
Oh, I can't wait to get drunk to this.
Okay, so fun story. I got my mom to watch all of Sarah for the end, and the first time she saw Kureto, she thought he was hot. And my only thing was like, no, mom, no. Please don't do this to me. Not again. Because my mom has a habit of liking every guy that I don't like.
Oh.
Like in Blue Exorcist, I love Rin, but she likes Yukio.
Oh my god.
Because my mom has shit taste in boys.
Anyway, so we're all freaking wrong. We're going back on the not so well known voice actor gravy train.
I know this guy. I know him.
I'm about to say, I would hope you know this person, Gigi. So the person voicing Kazuma is actually Justin Pate, who has actually been coming up a lot more recently, because some of the other major named roles that he has, because he has a lot of background roles and minor characters, but he has a few named ones. Most notably, I would have to say, would be Dagashikashi, though.
Toe Endo. Donor boyfriend. Continue. Yep.
You can also spoil who he is in
First Love Monster.
Oh, First Love Monster.
Okay, we'll get to that. He's also had major roles in Dragonaut the Resonance. First Love Monster, he's Arashi Nagasawa. Blah, blah, blah. Names. He's also had major roles in Initial D, Kamisama Kiss 2, Snow White with the Red Hair, and The Tower of Duraga. Again,
that's for you, Gigi.
Sending things. So how do we feel about Justin Pate? Because
I actually think he's really freaking great in this.
Welcome to my voice actor reverse harem, Justin Pate. Congratulations.
Yeah, because for me, the only other time I heard him was in Dagashikashi. And I enjoyed him there, but I kind of like this one a lot more, to be honest, because it's giving him an opportunity to not only take on a really major character, but it's a different kind of personality and a tone of voice that we're hearing compared to Toe from Dagashikashi, and I really like it, actually.
Every character he's played recently is so freaking different. Like, you have Stoner Toe, and then you have Arashi, who Catgirl Fujo bait, whatever. Oh my god, he's hysterical.
I haven't even seen
it. Makes a lot more sense when you watch the show.
Yes.
I don't plan on ever watching the show.
Okay, so Arashi's thing is that he has a fetish for this little catboy thing named what?
Renren,
who is voiced by Aaron. Is that voiced by Aaron Roberts? I don't even remember.
It's somebody in here.
Okay, I try to block as much as First Love Monster from my mind as I can, because I don't want to relive the horrible. I've been having nightmares for the last couple days, and I'm going to blame that. Look here, I listened to Eric Vale fake fuck Brent Aperol.
Whoa.
It was good. It was good.
You heard me, bitch.
Okay.
Anyway.
Okay, that's terrifying.
Anyway, so... There's a lot of things that are terrifying about First Love Monster, especially Chris Ryan talking about his wiener leaner.
But he's... Oh my god, he's so good as Kazu,
just
though.
The less,
I don't even want to know.
The less we think about First Love Monster, the more it hurts less.
Let's not talk about it.
So essentially, Justin Pate wants to fuck a tiny cat boy named Aaron Roberts. I mean, voiced by Aaron Roberts. Not named Aaron. Its name is Runner. Just kill me.
So anyway, Kazu is really good. He's, like, super enthusiastic, and it's different from all the other roles that I know him as. Go fight, win!
Oh, yeah. You can definitely tell he has the enthusiasm for,
He's so good, and I was like, damn, why are you not in more anime, son?
Justin. Oh, he's in plenty. It's just, why do you not have larger roles?
Why do you not have leads? And, I mean, I didn't make a lot of predictions for... spoilers for Servamp. I actually didn't make a lot of predictions, but I actually hope he's a character that's going to show up tomorrow in tomorrow's episode as of today's recording, named Licht, named Lich. But I really want him to be in more stuff, and I really hope he's in a lot of, fall broadcast subs. Face it, lady, say it with me. We all want Funimation to get Kiss Him, Not Me.
Yes.
Oh, please.
I
would love to see this guy in Kiss Him, Not Me.
He needs to be the best friend. The best friend. That's who he needs to be. The best boy.
Like, please let this guy show up in Kiss Him, Not Me. If they make another season of, like, Noragami, let him show up there.
Yep.
Let him show up in My Hero Academia as some of the new characters coming in.
Just give him a check. Let him be give him a things. Paycheck.
Give him more things.
Please let the- Yeah, please let there be a Kuroko's dub, because I would love to see this guy as somebody in that show.
Like I said, welcome to my voice actor reverse harem. This is a very elite list, and now it has six. Which I don't like, because it's not a multiple of five, but welcome aboard the Gigi train. Choo-choo, motherfucker.
But then you're only, but you're one six of a way to a 666 harem.
Oh my god, damn it.
Ooh.
So I guess the general consensus here is, Justin Pate, we love you. You should be in more leading things.
Marry me.
It's definitely solid. Absolutely solid. I love it so far right now, and... Yeah, I would love to hear him in more things.
10 out of 10 would do again.
Oh, god damn it. So I think we're ready to move on to our final character.
Woo!
So let's move on to Haruhi Bando. He is essentially, between the two, he is the actual lead. He's the one we follow the most through for the show and his perspective. He, again, in case you forgot the summary of the show, his family owns a judo dojo, and he's basically a guy that kind of got roped into judo because of his family, but he decides to quit because his buddy Kazuma is like, hey, let's quit together, I'm gonna start this male cheerleading thing, and you're gonna join me. So, and Bando, he's kind of more, he kind of takes on the more quiet, shy role sometimes, so he's currently getting over this awkwardness about being a male cheerleader. Because, of course, there's the whole stereotype of, but girls are cheerleaders. I've never seen a guy cheerleader before. So we have, of course, that bit for him
you
to get
see,
through.
You see, as somebody who went to school and actually had a lot of guy cheerleaders in their class, guy cheerleading is a thing.
Yeah. But anyway, predictions for Bando. I had two, but I did get this one correct.
Oh, snap.
I had three, and I got this correct.
I had two, and I was wrong.
Okay.
Womp, womp, womp.
I know. Do you want to go surprised? First? Yeah, I'll go first because first of all, again, Prince of Stride, so I had to put Austin Tindall.
Yep.
Austin Tindall.
I know, who would have thought? And then I don't remember who this guy is, but I put him anyway, so he probably was in Dance with Devils, and it's Gregory Lush.
Yes, that was
Was he the little satanic one?
No, he's the brother. He's the brother.
Lindo.
Thank you.
Oh, he's the if incest is let you like bass, put your cousin sister to the test.
Yes, that's him.
I believe he's Lindo. That's him.
That's him. That's who I, okay. Who I put.
All right, so my predictions were essentially the lowest hanging fruit I could grab. Mm-hmm. So my first prediction obviously was Justin Briner.
Me too. He was my other prediction.
My second prediction was Clifford.
Understandable.
And then the third one I obviously got right, and fitting for the state that they dubbed the show in.
Cheer it out, girls. Cheer it out.
It's like,
give me a D.
God damn it.
Give me the D. I mean, give me an A.
A?
A.
Give me an L.
L.
Give me... That was weak, Lilac.
Shut up!
Give me another L.
L.
Give me an A.
A.
Give me an S.
Yes.
What's that spell?
Dallas. We have Dallas Reed coming in as Haruhi Bando. Oh, that was actually really appropriate.
Dallas,
awesome.
Dallas Reed is also another gentleman I owe a beer to.
Let's get the cast of Pure Boys drunk.
I'm gonna assume it's because of Netoke, right?
Yep! Dallas Reed, the only reason Netoke was watchable.
Okay, yeah, I would actually have to agree with that. So, for other roles...
Okay, to be fair, because I'm not in that episode, despite my utter hatred of Akko the human brick, Jesus Christ, Trina Nishimura was super fucking good in that show.
Yeah, to be fair to Trina. But other roles that Dallas Reed has been in, he's been in Anastasia of a Rogue Hero, He's in Netoge, of course, as the lead Russian. He's also in First Love Monster.
Oh, that's right, he is!
As,
he's mini CL! He's baby CL.
He's CL okay. Junior.
Yeah. Oh my god. He's also in Honda-kun. Not gonna say where is it right now. He's Suzuha from Noragami Arigato. And he's also...
Please don't remind me of that.
Yeah. He's also the lead Kimito from Shomin Sample, as well as a variety of small background roles. He's one of the newer voices coming in, I would say, around...
Ripperino Suzuha.
I think he's basically, like, been coming up a lot more around the same time as Rest Rico has piss. Been.
Rest in piss, Suzuha.
God damn it. But, in terms of the performance itself, how do we feel about Dallas Reed?
Mother of Christ, can this kid act?
Yup! I love it.
Because here's the thing. I did not watch Shomin Sample. I don't hate myself that much.
Yeah, I got stuck with it.
You also got stuck with Divine Gate, so I don't know why you're the boss. You can be like, no, this show looks like absolute shit. No, I'm not. Oh, wait, you were doing seasonals for that.
That's probably what it was. I know I was doing seasonals for Divine Gate. I think I was doing seasonals for Shomin Sample, and that's why I kind of ended up getting roped into it, because I was already watching it.
But I mean, like, normally, poor Dallas Reed is like, the poor man, oh god, I hate to say this.
Oh no.
He's like the poor man Bryce Papenbrook who gets put in all these shitty hair
management. Oh
my god.
But I like Dallas Reed, because again, he was one part of what made Netoge actually watchable.
Yeah, honestly.
Also, B, have not watched Aesthetic of a Rogue Hero, because from what Hardy tells me, I will want to kill myself after.
I probably would too.
But I'm also trying not to vomit right now for some reason.
Please don't.
Oh, good god, why do I want to puke?
Ooh. You okay?
God, this is what happens when you think of Shomin Sample and Divine Gate in one
god
thought.
Damn it!
But like the only time, here's the thing about Bondo is his name.
Yep.
Haru, yeah.
Haruhi Bondo.
Yeah, Bondo has Haruhi Bondo. Bondo has his little comedic moment,
mm-hmm.
But he's not Wataru, who is right. Essentially comedy god incarnate of this show.
Yep.
He's much more of a serious character.
Much more serious, and a lot of the humor that comes from him is a lot more subtle.
Deadpan, maybe more deadpan, more subtle.
I wouldn't say deadpan, it's a lot more subtle, more than deadpan.
And so for me, the only thing I remember hearing Dallas Reed be in that was super, super serial was his little two-episode stint in Noragami.
Mm-hmm.
To which I wasn't the biggest fan of Dallas Reed in that. I think that, in all honesty, I actually thought that scene should have been handled by Justin Briner, but I'm not gonna blame Caitlin for that, and I think Dallas Reed did a good job given what he was given.
I think Dallas Reed was actually pretty good in Noragami as well.
Hummy. Again, I'm not saying it was bad. I thought it could be a little bit more fine-tuned, and I hope it will be a little bit more fine-tuned.
For the home video release.
For the DVD. Because that is such a heavy scene.
It really is.
Those are some really heavy scenes. But I think that he does a freaking amazing job in this. And again, this is another series I want... Another guy I want to start seeing in other dubs. Like, I would really like to see him be in... God, what were some shows we were talking about coming out? I would love to see Dallas Reed in Kiss Him, Not Me, if we get it.
Oh, absolutely.
Oh, yes.
Definitely.
If Crunchyroll license it, but they do a thing like Free, where Funimation dubs it, I'd actually really, really like to see either Justin or Dallas play Atsushi.
Which one is he?
I think Dallas would... The Tiger.
Oh, okay.
I don't know the franchise at all, so...
Oh, you will.
I thought you watched... You've watched Bunigo Stray Dogs.
Oh, Bunigo. Sorry.
Oh, I thought you were talking about something else. Never mind.
But I thought you were talking about Kiss Him, Not Me for
me
a second.
Too.
No, not Kiss Him, Not Me. I said I would like to see him in Kiss Him, Not Me. But I'm saying if there's a series... Like, Crunchyroll does what they did with Free, where Funimation dubs it, but Crunchyroll distributes it. For Bunigo Stray Dogs, I would like to actually see Dallas Reed as Atsushi.
Ooh, that would actually be a really good pick, actually.
Dallas or Justin.
Mm.
And God forbid if they cast Vic Mignogna as Daisai, I am going to actually kill him. do not fucking do this to me, Funimation. Do not fucking do this to me, Crunchy. But I want to see Dallas Reed get to do not only more roles like this, I do want to see him do comedy stuff like Shomin and I guess like Netsuji, but I really don't want him to be cast as the harem lead guy.
Yeah.
Because I think he can do so much more.
Yeah, this show in particular, he's definitely getting the chance to branch out a lot more.
Yeah.
And ironically enough, it's another Aaron Dismuke dub to boot, because he did do, he was the lead for Shomin Sample, which Aaron did direct. So
yeah, but, I'm like, oh god, I just lost my thought. It like went away into, oh.
Do you want me to talk more and get your thought
no,
back?
No, I got it. Because as much as I shit on him for Kaz in First Love Monster, who I hated and thought should have spoken with a tiny, tiny British accent, like CL Jr., I thought
he should have been voiced by Brita Fuller.
Pretty much. He was really good here. Like, he's very sensitive. And actually, like, in my head, I picture Haru to be, like, a little more nerdy. But he played it so normal. And I was like, I think that's the best part of this dub, actually. That instead of taking the nerdy route, which would have been really easy, everyone just sounds normal. And that's hard to do in an anime dub when everybody has squeaky mouse voices and runs around and says senpai. And I think that it's good for him to sound like a normal guy.
Yeah, absolutely. Like, honestly, I enjoyed his performance in Netsuji. From what I remember of Shomin Sample, his performance in particular, he was new to me at that point, so I wasn't quite. I thought it was decent, like, for a starting kind of major role. Here, as of right now, I'm gonna say this is the best that I've seen Dallas Reed do so far.
I agree.
Personally. Because not only is he out of the harem issue right here, and he's playing much more serious, more straightforward role. So it's very different side to him, and I think he plays that whole, quiet personality, with the slight twinge of awkward, not Watcher levels of awkward, but the slight twinge of awkward rather well, and I'm really enjoying it so far. So,
you know what? You know what makes me think now, too, is that I still really do hope Sentai, we need to have a talk. Fucking dub Haikyuu, you pieces of shit.
Yes, please.
I'm actually thinking he would be a really good, Dallas 3 would actually be really fucking good in Haikyuu.
Probably,
he should be the orange-haired kid.
I think he would actually, no.
I didn't see him as Hinata.
I would actually think he'd be a really good Kageyama.
Ooh.
Which one is he?
He's
the black haired one.
Oh, the tall one? The setter?
The setter.
The king of the court.
Oh, he would be a good setter.
I have a dream cast for Haikyuu, by the way, that I keep on needing to update as more boys get introduced to me.
I need to make a dream
My
cast.
Only stipulation is this Sentai film works. Y'all fucking stupid if Chris Patton is not Okawa. Y'all are fucking dumb. Let me direct Haikyuu's dub. Let me be your casting director for that show. I got this shit in the bag.
We gotta move down to Texas first, Megan, remember?
Shh. Don't let them know our plans for world domination. I mean, anime world domination.
I'm sorry. Forget I said anything. So I think the general consensus for Dallas Reed here is bravo, sir. Bravo, sir.
Please get to play. Please play more actual, like, adulty adult roles. I would really like to see him get into more adult stuff.
Rather than him.
I don't know other releases coming out this year. Also, be if Tokyo Ghoul Route A ever actually gets an anime and dub, I now have a position for you to take.
Well, that sounded a little dirty.
Whoa.
Also, I have to actually do a Kuroko's, prediction in case of emergency. At this point, I really should make a Kuroko's. I should really make a Kuroko's prediction list, but I just haven't done it yet. And I'm like, the only thing I know is Eric Vale equals Aomine. I will hear no substitute.
The green haired guy from Shutoku has to be Tatum. That is all.
Yeah. Oh god. Yeah. Oh green. Oh Lilac hasn't met basketball Tatum.
Okay.
Well, maybe next dub talk, ladies' night. Cross your fingers.
Oh my god. So
Lilac's already watching Kuroma's Cup, remember? So, okay, anyway, back to the finale.
I was like, back to this. I'll let you guys talk about Kuroko after we're done. But going overall thoughts on the dub as of right now, how do we feel overall about the dub for Cheer Boys as of now?
Why isn't Aaron Dubuque directing more things?
Because I know, he's right? too busy in my harem to direct things.
Yeah,
like
I would.
It's so weird, but I haven't watched Show Meet and Sample, and I did not. Did Aaron Dub do any of the spring or winter dubs?
He was assistant for Fairy Tail Zero and Enride. I remember that.
Doesn't he have something to do with Escaflowne?
But he was also in Enride.
He's in
Escaflowne. Escaflowne somewhere. But we can't say where. though if you've seen the trailer,
you know where he is.
Or if you're in the Kickstarter, you know where he is. I think the best thing about this dub, and it's really weird because I don't think any other dub this year has captured this. And it's not because of the directing or because of the acting, but I think it's more because of the show that it's in.
Right.
Is that Aaron has done a really good job capturing genuine sincerity and in a natural sense to this show.
Yep, I agree.
And I say that, and again, this is not saying Mike and Felicia and Caitlin and Zach and Chris and other Chris and whoever the fuck else is directing crap is doing a bad job. It's that, because of the way Cheer Boys as a show is laid out, there's such a natural sense of sincerity and genuineness to it that comes across really, really well in English that I maybe wouldn't have gotten the Japanese. Again, I haven't watched the Japanese take of this, so I can't 100% say. But I think Aaron's directing has captured that. But I also think it may help Aaron's age, because Aaron is the same age as a lot of these guys.
This is also true.
Yes, yes.
Because Aaron is, I believe, a year younger than I am.
Sounds about right.
He's in his 20s.
I want to say Aaron's a year or two younger than me. Because I remember seeing him a lot at cons when he was younger, and they used to joke that he was a baby and that he couldn't know bad
yep,
things.
Yep, he is 23.
Yep, so he is just about a year younger than I am.
Oh my god.
This is something around, so I wonder if there's a sense that because this character's around his own age, that he also knows has a sense of what college-aged guys sound like. And there's not a lot of bros and American slang or anything thrown into it. It's very respectfully done. And I honestly think compared to, First Love Monster, which is, I think should have gone full gag dub at this point, it does a really good job, and even compared to some of the stuff on Double Talk, I actually like it a lot more.
Yeah.
I openly like it a lot more than De Greyman Hollow, but I think the original De Greyman dub wasn't very good in the first place.
I know nothing about De Greyman, so I just kind of...
Yeah. I do not like the De Greyman dub at all, except for maybe a few roles. I think it's good. I like it a little bit more than I think I like Tales of Zestiria, the cross with the X. But I think that's just because Tales of Zestiria X is, that show I watch that's super pretty but makes no fucking sense. And then I can't say how I feel about Servant because I have an episode to record in, a day and a half.
Well, yeah. I mean, that being said, when I saw Cheer Boys, just the title and just, the first couple of pictures we got, I was like, oh my god, this is going to be the best Fujo bait, shoujo trashiest, campiest anime ever. I can't.
No, fucking... that's going to be Yuri on Ice.
Well, yes, but of the summer. And I was like, oh, this is going to be so fucking great. I can't wait to camp the fuck out and be all Fujo about it. And then I watched it and I was like, oh shit, this is nothing like I actually expected. And it's actually very realistic. It's very I've never seen a male cheerleading team, but I could imagine that these guys could all be one put together. And as far as the Japanese dub goes, it is a little more campy than the English dub. But nature and the tone of the show, I think that the English dub is doing it right. Yeah, we're going to cheer. We're going to have Go Fight Win in there. We're going to be really authentic with it. And I think that this dub is really authentic as you can be about a male cheerleading squad. It's just, it's very real, it's very sincere, and that's so hard to capture in the anime world of camp. So Bravo to everyone involved. I'm shaking my pom-poms at you. Take that how you will. Go fight, win.
Win.
Yeah.
She's talking about the ones on her hand, not the ones in her shirt.
Am I?
Jesus.
Am, but is she? I will say, I mean, before, I hate to cut you off, Steph, but I mean, I hate the fact, like, because we all know I have a huge gripe with the fucking freedom.
Yep.
To which, as campy as Free is also an incredibly powerful emotional show that I wish had more sincerity and levity handled in it. That this show is also very, has a lot of levity and emotionality in it, especially for Bondo's character. Yep. Where he does feel like he doesn't, and especially it's very odd that in Japan we have a male character unable to impress his older sister character. He's not able to overcome a female character. So he goes into this more female-oriented sport where you have the sister who's in a much more known male-oriented sport, even though in America, I think, like, the most famous judo athlete is a chick right now, thanks Olympics for ending in, like, 2 days before this. I think that I want to see more sports anime, especially because, again, Haikyuu has no dub to it. Ace of the Diamond does not have a dub
but
to it.
But this isn't a typical sports anime. This is way more slice of life than sports.
And I think that helps, because like, Aaron is really freaking good at dubbing slice of life anime.
Yeah.
Yep.
Like, honestly, despite how bad some of the shows he's had to direct are, he actually is a really good director. And this is probably, going like Dallas for like 5 seconds, this is the strongest directing I've seen from Aaron Disney. And it's for a sports anime about male cheerleading, of all things. First of all. So, honestly, you guys basically have said the majority of my thoughts too. Like, props to Aaron. This is really solid directing and keeping it more of a straightforward script, which has me curious as to who the scriptwriter is for this, because good on you for adapting this in this way as well.
Show yourself.
Yeah, but the
post
other
in
big
the comments
thing, like,
down below.
But the other big thing too, like, and I mentioned it a couple of times, a lot of the characters that we've seen with the press release are fairly new or not really voice actors you see all that much, save from, like, Clifford Chapin. So, this, I enjoy the cast.
And there's so many more guys that are going to be in this by the end of it.
Yep.
Because, like, if you've seen the opening, you see the whole damn team.
Yep.
I want to know who plays Afro motherfucker, by the way.
Yeah, that'll be interesting. But,
Bevin's poor for work.
But it'll be interesting to see how these characters grow, and for the voice actors who voice at least these initial 7 guys, see how that grows and develops, especially for Dallas, for Justin, for Kyle, for Jared, for Chris George, for Alejandro Saab, in particular, those big 6 right there. Like, because you don't hear them that often in large roles, minus Dallas, because he's been getting up there lately. But I really want to hear more from these guys. I really do. And this is really, really solid. So honestly, I'm probably going to be keeping watching the show, but I'm going to stick with the dub rather than the Japanese. Because this dub has been really enjoyable so far, and I feel like, just so I can, because there's a lot of seasonal things, and I always like to save some time rather than trying to watch both tracks at the same time. So I'll probably just stick to the dub on this one if I do decide to go.
That's what I'm going to do. I'm probably actually going to wait until the dub ends. And then I'm just gonna watch, just marathon through the whole dub, once it's over. Again, I think that I really hope that the dubs of, like, shows like Cheer Boys, like Prince of Stride, like Free, are getting really successful.
Yeah.
Because, again, I really, really, I don't know how, what I have, who do I have to murder or sell my organs to get a fucking Kuroko dub, for the love of Christ. But I want to see shows like this succeed, because, again, we have, I think, All Out's coming out in the fall.
Oh, God.
We're gonna have Yuri on Ice.
Yep. More sports.
Obviously, Days is out right now, but unfortunately Pony Canyon has that, but that would have been a fucking amazing dub to have.
Oh, totally.
Because Days is a freaking amazing show.
It is.
Days is a really fucking good anime. As somebody who watches that for seasonals, that is the easiest show to get through.
Isn't it? I love Days. Anyway.
Days is
it is the easy... Okay, it is easier to get through Days than it is to get through Sweetness and Lightning.
Yeah, I can't watch actually, Sweetness and Lightning.
Actually, it is. I love Sweetness and Lightning, but yeah, Days actually is a lot easier to get through.
And I want to see, like, more sports... I want my damn hockey anime, too, by the way.
one of these days.
One of these days I'll get my hockey and my curling anime. Damn it, Japan. We will fix this problem. But I really want to see... I want to see it succeed, because I want to get... Like I said, the big fish for me that's still kind of... there's two really big fish still out there in the sports anime pool. And it is amazing that neither Daya no Ace or Kuroko's Basketball have no dub. And I want to see that, and I really want to see a team like Funimation handle it. And for me right now, it's a toss-up between Caitlin and Aaron, who I want to actually direct that show, because I think they're the only two directors at Funimation who's shown a sports anime some respect.
Yeah, as of right now.
I don't know who did the directing for Big Wind Up. I want to say it was Chris Bevins. But I'm just gonna go to Anime News Network for it.
Like, I'm just going there now, actually.
If you get that, I want to get the other sports anime I think has the best dub to it.
Go down the list. The answer.
I want to say Big Wind Up.
Oh, the answer to your question, there's actually five directors.
Why are there five directors?
They did a variety of episodes. So it's Christopher Bevins who did the first seven. J. Michael Tatum did 14 through 18. Joel McDonald did 8 through 13. Arbruce Elliott did 19 through 22. And Terry Doty did 9 episodes throughout. So it looks like 14 to 18 and 23 to 26.
All right. And then to kind of go over the other, I think, sports anime that had like the best dub to it is Bamboo Blade, which Tyler Walker handled the first 9 episodes, and Chris Kasten handled the last 16.
Yeah.
You know.
So, I mean, I think that you can do these really good dubs. I just really, really want to see... I want to see more handling like Aaron and Caitlin did, as opposed to Jerry and Tatum, though I do really like Jerry dubs. But that's... my own gripe, and I could go on for fucking hours.
Yeah. Are you saying Prince of Tennis was a horrible dub? What are you saying?
I'm saying that I think Free the Eternal Summer and Free have some of the worst.
I like
the worst dubs I've ever
seen. I like the Free Eternal Summer dub.
But that's neither here nor there.
Here nor there.
So, overall, definitely solid. And yeah, I do hope, like, dubs like this and like Princess Stride, it gets the chance to bring sports anime back, because I know there years ago, from what I know of, sports anime was not the most successful thing to put out there. But yeah, I'm hoping like dubs like this, that'll definitely help bring it back a lot more, because there is a fan base for sports anime, and it's really
You're looking at it.
Yeah, first of all, hi. But it's really...
it's us ladies.
It's really been coming up and becoming a lot more popular in recent years. So I am hoping that this helps bring more sports anime over and get it dubbed. But if you're interested yourself in checking out the English dub for Cheer Boys, you can do so every Tuesday on Funimation's website. The actual simulcast, I believe, because I'm looking at the schedule that they have, the actual simulcast for Cheer Boys is at 10:30 a.m., with a 1 week subscriber paywall for episodes, and then the English dub is also at 10:30 a.m. for the broadcast dub, but the broadcast dub is under the elite subscriber paywall. If you're interested in checking out the dub itself, they do have a 14-day free trial, of course, which you can sign up, watch those cheer boys cheer, and of course at the end of the 14 days, if you do not want to keep the subscription, you would have to cancel it. Because, again, as I always like to say, they do ask for credit card information. So if you don't cancel after 14 days, money gets pulled, and you're kind of stuck. But if you want to at least watch Cheer Boys itself, the simulcast is up, and it is free. The recent, most recent episode is stuck behind the subscriber paywall. As of right now, there are 4 episodes, I believe, of the dub for Cheer Boys, because the newest one must have come out today.
Yep.
And then I believe simulcast-wise...
I want to say 7, because 5.5 was a recap.
Yeah. Basically 7. 5.5 was a recap, but there are 8 episodes total, 7 for the actual show itself, that are up as well as of today. But I think that's about it. Episode-wise, there's a lot of shit going on.
I'm doing, like, I think I have the most episodes doing this week.
Oh, you probably do. Correct. You probably...
Okay, are we going from Friday to Friday, Friday to Sunday, as of last Friday to Sunday? Okay, so I just did First Love Monster. Woo! I did, Cheer Boys today. I do Sir Vamp on Thursday. I do Love Life Sunshine Friday. And then I do Danganronpa Despair and Danganronpa Future on Sunday back to back.
Oh my god, you guys are going to die. I think we're just doing Despair because we're going to wait for episode 4 for Future. I think that was the plan.
Oh, okay. Then I'm doing Despair. And then I think we're also hopefully going to be doing other stuff soon. I think the original Goats.
The original Goats have things planned.
By the way, Gigi.
What up?
There's a chat, it's just me, Hardy, and Lilac. It's called Original Goats.
Oh my god.
Yep. And then I think, god, what do I have? Cheer Boys is the first summer broadcast up that I recorded. And then I'm doing Danganronpa Sunday. But I'm also, we're actually going to be recording an episode for One Punch Man this week.
Woo!
Yeah, I think One Punch Man and Love Life are going simultaneously. Yeah. Like Saki Kai is going with us today.
Basically. But then I'm also doing Honda-kun, and of course Danganronpa Future Arc, and
Oh, are we doing Honda-kun this weekend too?
No, we're not doing, that's not scheduled yet, because I know there's, like, people have birthdays, and people have other things going on, so I think we're holding off on that.
Oh yeah, that's right, I'm getting absolutely shit-faced on Saturday.
Well, as of right now, it's not scheduled. I think we might try to aim for
Do you want to come to my house and get shit-faced on Saturday? Yes.
I would love to. I have to work I have to work Saturday morning, but I'll find a way to get down there. But
there's probably a flight at like 4:00.
Anyway,
it's only gonna be $200.
Yeah, I'm broke as fuck right now.
I know you're broke until YomaCon. That's why we're gonna feed you cake.
Yay!
But anyway, ladies,
and sneak you across.
Ladies,
the
is there anything you wanted to plug or talk about before we end the episode?
Sadly, nobody's plugging their wife today.
What?
What?
Gigi remembers.
I didn't hear what you said. You broke up.
Nobody's plugging their wife today.
God damn it.
Fuck my life. Well, anyway, my name is Gigi. I'm from Animepalooza. I have a YouTube channel where I do unboxings and I talk about the summer season of anime because it was made specifically for me and all my Fujo friends. And I like to talk about boys. And please follow me on Twitter and subscribe to my channel. And I don't know. I don't have anything else.
Megan, your turn. Go.
Yes, but I'm also watching a friend's Facebook video peeling a pancake off a pan. Anyway. anyway, and then I realized it was just a repeating GIF and I'm an idiot. So, my name is Megan. I am one of the 4 horrible hostesses of Anime America podcast, where we talk about anime, do top 10s, and have our podcast, Anime America Reboot, that is currently on SoundCloud and iTunes. Thank you, Brad, and your money. We have a guy host on that, and he's adorable. I also write for the Infinite Rainy Day seasonals. I'm currently covering Sir Vamp, Sweetness and Lightning, Days, and Oz Mafia.
I feel so bad for you.
Oh, Lord.
I have no idea what's happening in Oz Mafia. I, honest to God, have no idea what's going
on. No one does.
I used to have the First Love Monster and Suki Uda, but I dropped those.
Fuck you.
Because Suki Uda is like watching paint dry.
Fuck you.
And First Love Monster makes me feel bad about myself.
Fuck you.
I love you too, Gigi.
You're my bae.
It's okay, bae. I love you. I'll buy you Midori and vodka. I'll buy you Vanique.
Oh, God.
Anyway, back to plugging myself, because I'm single and alone.
You and me both, sister.
Oh god. You this and me just both. Got really weird.
I'm single and alone. Hell yeah, dude. You can also follow me at Twitter at QueenEra2, where I post mostly random depression, why doesn't anybody love me post, spoilers for anime, cute pictures, and hit on, and passive aggressively maybe hitting on a follower, a mutual follower of mine, but you'll never know who that is. So, Lilac knows who it is, and if she fucking says it, I'll kill her.
I'm not gonna say anything.
Girl talk, tell us.
Anyway.
Afterwards, later.
But if you want to follow me, go ahead and do that. I also post a lot of Voltron picture because Pidge's best character.
And as for me...
I also am addicted to buying Fire Emblem shirts.
Yes, you are. And as for me, obviously you found this episode somehow, so obviously you just found my channel, where I typically I do reviews, vlogs, unboxings, a bunch of variety of things, which I am terrible at making sure I actually do because massive review weeks are a thing that I haven't done yet, finished, and so many things. And that's basically all that I do. My life right now is revolving around DubDub because there's so many episodes, of course. But if you want to follow me on Twitter, you can do so as well at Lilac Anime Review with reviews about REVUE, where I just post about being tired and editing and work and a variety of random things. But I believe that is everything we have going on for today. So thank you very much for joining us on Dub Talk, and as we and we're gonna cheer and cheer boys and all this fun stuff. I don't know how I'm ending this right now.
Two, four, six, eight. Who do we appreciate? Cheer boys. Cheer boys. Go cheer boys.
Cheer boys. Basically, yeah. It's like 10:30. It's time to go to bed. Anyway.
Yeah, I'm tired.
2, 4, 6, 8. Who do we appreciate? Voice actors. Voice actors. Go voice actors.
2, 4, 6, 8. Who's the biggest Fujo bait?
Megan! Oh, wait. Kurokos! Kurokos! Go Kurokos!
Bye!
And with that, it's time to call it a night. So until next time, guys, have a good night and otaku on, my friends.
2, 4, 6, 8. Who do I want to see procreate?
You
love your face, Megan, but we need to stop.
Go
take the wine away.
Megan! Oh, God.